Everybody, how are you? Welcome to church. Thanks for being the church. I got to keep up with my own language as I'm trying to change all these terms and just the way we talk about ourselves. So, but anyways, thanks for coming back out this morning. It's a beautiful day. I see many of you brought some chairs. You can hang out. That's wonderful. A couple things that we do want to announce here before we get started this morning is we are still putting out this Connect card. So if you have a prayer request, or if you are with us and you're new this morning, we ask that you just go ahead and fill this out. And then when you leave the parking lot, we will have our yellow jackets out and that you, with buckets that you can go ahead and put your cards and your offerings in the bucket as you leave this morning. So just wanted to kind of put that out there for you. Also, just a couple of things just to talk about as we're just kind of continuing on in our opening and reopening and just trying to find ways of connecting with each other. This past week, we had the great opportunity to get a bunch of food and through another outreach that they had more than they can use. And so we got a bunch of that food. And so we were able to give literally a ton of milk to New Hope Ministries. So I had it all loaded down in my car. I was popping wheelies all the way from York into Hanover to do that. So, and then also we got like 60, almost 70 boxes of produce that we were able to share with the Council of Churches, share with the God's Meal Barrel, and also with the Adams Rescue Mission, right? That's a rescue mission. As well as many other people from the community here from New Hope was able to come and bring their cars, and we're able to give them some of those vegetables. And so we just want to, we're going to continue to look for those kinds of opportunities that we can be able to serve and be an outreach minded during this time. So one of the things that we're looking at doing is we're actually looking at doing a movie night. And so that's, we're looking at doing that, I believe, I don't have the date in front of me, Wes. Is it the 11th? Okay, so it's going to be, is that a Saturday night? Yeah. So Saturday, June 11th, we're going to be doing a movie night here in the parking lot. So we'll probably be over here somewhere, and just, we're not going to have all the fixings with it, with food and all, and drinks and all that kind of stuff. It is the 13th. Okay. It's okay. Sorry. I'm talking to Wes. So we're just having a communication here between each other. So anyways, we're looking at right now, June 11th, which is a Saturday night, and also July 13th, which is a Saturday night. Oh my Lord. Just look at your calendars. Okay. So we'll have the dates posted. Is it in the bulletin? All right. Sorry. I'm not looking at the bulletin because it's too complicated here. So just look at your bulletin, communicate that to your friends and to your neighbors, and invite them to come out, have them bring their own popcorn and drink, and bring a lawn chair, and we're just going to have a great night. So we're still picking the movie, so we'll announce that next week, okay? All right. Okay, also, the noisy offering. Today is the 31st of May, and I don't know if anybody remembered to bring your noisy offering. We're going to do that as well. So we'll just if you say, oh, I forgot, go ahead and bring it next week as well. So we'll be prepared this week and next week for noisy offering. So a noisy offering is loose change that you've maybe collected through the course of the last quarter, and those of you we give it to the youth, and then the youth actually talk about ways of using those finances to serve the community, the youth community specifically. They've been trying to target. So I encourage you just to go ahead and do that this Sunday as well as next Sunday as well. We'll bring that because I know I have a bunch of stuff at my house that I forgot to bring for this Sunday as well. Okay, let's go ahead and get started.
Lord of life, of love, of peace, of time itself, we stand in awe of your eternal presence and resurrection power. We open our lives once again to your involvement. Come, Lord Jesus, as you sit in heaven, be seated here on the throne of our hearts. Amen.
Peter chapter 2 verse 24, it says, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. If we could just take a few minutes and ask the Lord if there's anything in our hearts or in our lives that's actually standing between us and him. Our Heavenly Father, in His infinite mercy, has sent His only Son into the world for your salvation, and for His sake forgives you all your sins. Therefore, by the authority of Jesus Christ and in His name, I declare to you that your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Good morning, New Hope. Our first reading this morning comes to us from the book of Numbers, chapter 11, verses 24 through 30. So Moses went out and told the people the words of the Lord, and he gathered 70 men of the elders of the people and placed them around the tent. Then the Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to him, and took some of the spirit that was on him and put it on the 70 elders. And as soon as the spirit rested on them, they prophesied, but they did not continue doing it. Now two men remained in the camp, one named Eldad and the other named Medad, and the spirit rested on them. They were among those registered, but they had not gone out to the tent, and so they prophesied in the camp. And a young man ran and told Moses, Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp. And Joshua, the son of Nun, the assistant of Moses from his youth, said, "My lord Moses, stop them." But Moses said to him, "Are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the Lord's people were prophets, that the Lord would put his spirit on them?" And Moses and the elders of Israel returned to the camp. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Our second reading this morning comes to us from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 1 through 21. When the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as of fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now there were dwellings in Jerusalem, Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And at this sound, the multitude came together, and they were bewildered, because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. And they were amazed and astonished, saying, "Are not all these men speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians, we hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God." And all were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others mocking said, "They're filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea, all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and give ear to my words. For these people are not drunk, as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day. But this is what was uttered through the prophet Joel. And in the last days it shall be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even on my male servants and female servants, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in the heaven above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the day of the Lord comes, the great and magnificent day. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
Our gospel is taken out of John chapter 7, verses 37 through 39. On the last day of the feast, the great day, Jesus stood up and cried out, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scriptures have said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water." Now this he said about the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were to receive, for as yet the Spirit had not been given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. Here ends the gospel of the Lord. So this is the church's birthday. This is the day on Pentecost Sunday when the church was birthed after Jesus was sent back, went back to be with his Father. But when he did that, he said, I'm going to promise you something. I'm not going to send, not going to have you stay here by yourself. I'm actually going to ask you to do something for me. And he said to them, I'm going to ask you to go back. To go back and wait. Don't do anything. I need you to wait. Because I'm sending the Spirit to you and he's going to lead you. And so amazingly, the apostles and all that were following with him did just that. They went back and they waited. And I think one of the reasons why they did that is because they honestly didn't know what to do. And I also think that they were really scared. 40 days before that, before Jesus left, they watched Jesus die a horrific death. They watched him bleed to death on that cross. And then 3 days later, in a mind-blowing way, they watched Jesus come back to life, not in a resurrected way, or not in a resuscitated way, but in a resurrected way, with a whole new body. And then they spent the next month or so walking with Jesus and trying to learn from him. And who knows what all they did and all they talked about. But one of the things that they learned was that Jesus's plan was far bigger than anything that they can even fathom. None of them even fathomed him going to the cross and dying the way he did. So as a result of all that, when Jesus told them to go back and to sit and to wait for the Holy Spirit, I think they thought to themselves, yeah, I'm going to do that because I don't have a clue what I'm going to do, right? I almost feel like we're in that same boat today. I almost feel as if that we don't really know what to do. The stuff that's going on with the coronavirus by itself is confusing. Now, on top of that, you're adding all these other things that are going on with the riots and all the stuff that had happened in Minneapolis. And honestly, I think the last thing that people really need right now is somebody else's opinion on the matter. I think we need to get God's heart on what's going on. And if anything, now more than ever before, the world doesn't need the church's opinion. The world actually needs the church to be empowered by the Holy Spirit like it was on those first days of Pentecost, and to be able to come with power and to bring life to a very, very, very confused world that we're living in right now. You and I, we're the church. Those first apostles, those first disciples, those first followers of Jesus, they ran their race and they did a lot of things really well and they did a lot of things not so well. But it didn't really matter because one of the very first things that they did well was that they went back and they waited for the Holy Spirit to come. The Holy Spirit came. The Holy Spirit is with us right now. He doesn't need to come again. He's been here all along. He doesn't go back and forth from earth to heaven and wait for other people to call back and forth. That's not what he does. He was actually sent here to guide us, the church, in how to be salt and light and how to be that witness for Jesus. If we were to look at that verse again out of Acts chapter 2 that Dawn just read, in verse 1 through 4 it says, when the day of Pentecost arrived. Now it's really important to understand that Pentecost was actually something that they, in the Old Testament, that they celebrated. That was already a Jewish holiday, if you will, okay, that came after Passover. That was something that was already built in there. It wasn't something that was new. All right? So they were, that's one of the reasons why there were so many people in Israel from all the different places that you braved yourself on in trying to read all those different names, okay? So all those, there's reason why they were there, because they were there to celebrate Pentecost. They were all together, and that's the people, the disciples of Jesus, they were all together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as of fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. I'm not going to read the whole story, but one of the things I could tell you is that there was no doubt what was happening to them. They knew what it was like to be in the presence of Jesus. And when the Holy Spirit came, it was not confusion to them, because it felt the exact same way. When the Holy Spirit came, they knew that this is exactly what was being promised. They didn't know how it was going to come. They didn't know what was going to happen. They didn't know that they were going to be speaking in different languages. They didn't know that tongues of fire were going to be sitting over them. They had no idea all that was going to happen. But you know what? Honestly, that didn't matter, because what they were looking for was the power of the Holy Spirit to come on them so that they would actually know what to do next. So now we're over 2,000 years removed from that series, that event. And we could talk about it from a historical standpoint, but what's that got to do with us today? So what? Who cares? Who cares what happened back then? We're living in the 21st century. Is the Holy Spirit still here? Yes. Is he still just as powerful then as he is, was he then, as he is today, as he was back then at that first appearance? He's not the kind of guy that drains his battery. Okay, the Holy Spirit has not lost any power. If anything, he's wanting to increase. He wants that we're one day closer to the coming of Jesus Christ the second time. He is here so that we can speak to the generations that are on the earth today and be able to declare the goodness of God and be able to live it out in front of them. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20, it says, "Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own." I think today more than ever, we have to remember that. We have to remember that as the church. If we call Jesus Christ our Lord and Savior, we have forfeited a right to ourselves. We are not our own. "For you were bought with a price, so glorify God in your body." So when the Holy Spirit came, we're not even totally sure where they were at. Some think that they were in the upper room. Some think that he was somewhere in the temple courts, as they were celebrating the Feast of Pentecost. They don't know totally where they're at, because it didn't really matter where they were at. Who cares where they were at? The matter is that the Holy Spirit came to them where they were, and filled their hearts and filled their lives. And that's where they began to hear God's voice from within. We are now that temple because of what Jesus Christ did for us. As we all got out of our houses and we all came in and we parked into this lot, now you and I are basically saying, "I'm going to follow Jesus. I want to follow him. I want to discover who he is and where he's going." But the question is, do we realize that by calling ourselves followers of Jesus, we actually ask the Holy Spirit to abide within us and to be our temple, our hearts and our lives, and for us to be able to understand that we're not our own anymore? It's not about me. It's about what God wants. So before I go asking, I want to do this, and I want to do that, and I want to go over here, am I asking the question, Lord Jesus, where do you want me to go? Holy Spirit, where are you leading me? Where are you directing me? Where should I go today? Because I'm not my own. I chose to follow you, and I'm going to follow you today. If the church, we rise up and begin to act from that place, I want to tell you something. The world will be a better place. Because the church as a whole will begin to listen to the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit actually knows how to fix all the things that we got going on. Do you realize that? The Holy Spirit knows how to fix it all. He's not confused. He's not leaning over heaven thinking, what's going on there? No, he knows exactly what's going on. And he's waiting for the church. He's waiting for you and me. He's waiting for New Hope Faith Community to say, sir, where do you want me to go? What do you want me to do? You saved me. I am no longer my own. Where do you want me to be? And then when he says it, okay, realizing when he says something to you, it may risk your life. It may change your life. In John 16, verses 13 and 14, so it's when the Spirit of truth comes, and he's come, this is Jesus that's speaking, when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, that's Jesus. The Spirit will glorify Jesus, and Jesus glorified the Father. They're one. They're not fighting amongst themselves, which I'm thankful for. They all are in agreement with what their plan is. They were always in agreement. They never had to create a plan B. Okay? He will glorify me, for he will take what is mine and declare it to you. So what the Spirit speaks is what Jesus speaks. And what Jesus speaks is what the Father speaks. So what the Father speaks, the Spirit speaks. You get that? And he will give that truth to you and me. The truth, he will give it to us. And then we can declare truth, because the truth will set you what?
Free.
Say it really loud so that I can hear you.
Free.
Thanks. So the Spirit will set you free. And right now, there's people that need to be set free. Do you agree with me on that one? Can we all agree to that?
Yeah.
And who exactly? All right, thanks. And who do you think has the freedom? It should be the church, because we have the Spirit, and the Spirit has the truth. One more scripture here before we move on. Out of Acts chapter 2. Verse 42, this is what the first church did. So sometimes the best thing for us to do is when we don't know what to do, we kind of go back to the basics. Typically, that's what we should do. So when you're in a place where you're not real sure, maybe you go back to the last thing that you know for sure. Does that make sense? So if you're in a place of confusion, it's like, I don't even know what to do. What's the last thing you knew what to do? What is that thing? And for the church, what's the last thing? What did they do? Well, it tells us in Acts chapter 2, verses 42 through 47. And they, the body of Christ, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, number one. Number two, and the fellowship. We all like to do that here. To the breaking of bread. And that's not just communion, okay? To the breaking of bread and the prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were settling and they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. So this is one of those particular passages that you need to take a moment and actually sit down with and to write down. Okay, what did they do? What did they do? How do we apply that today? How do we work that out today? Because the Word of God is actually very, very practical. You think to yourselves, well, they weren't living in today's age. You're right. Today's a different type of day. But there's some things that transcend time. Food is one of them. Don't you agree with that? All right? Food is something that transcends time. Fellowship transcends time. God's Word transcends time. Relationships transcend time. There's certain things in this thing that's just truth. And it's just real. And for us to go back over that, to look that passage up again on your own, in Acts chapter 2, starting in verse 42 to the end of the chapter, and just breaking it down. God, what's this mean for me? Because if we start doing the things that they were doing, we're going to see the things that they saw. I promise you that. I promise you that. I've seen that. I've seen it. I've seen communities come together and work together. I've seen communities become one. And as a result of their oneness, they saw great things happen. It wasn't a matter of how many people were in attendance. That didn't matter. The church only started with a few hundred people, and it grew to over 3,000 in a matter of minutes. God is not put out by the limitations of people. What he's put out is when people choose to follow their ways and not his. Let's pray. So Jesus, we just want to thank you, because this being the church's birthday, you want to do something on this day in our lives. God, you want to actually make us one. You want to make us to a place where we can actually bring life to a very, very broken and confused world. So I pray, Holy Spirit, for us here at New Hope Faith Community, that we would actually be part of the solution. That we would be a group of people that cry out to you, Holy Spirit, to empower us. So that we can be what you've called us to be in the time that we're here on this planet. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
let's share together in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Lord, you have asked us to deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow you. Even when our spirits are willing, the flesh is weak. You know our hearts, Father. Help us with your Holy Spirit to examine our hearts and hear from you. The longer we walk with you, the more we look like you. We desire to become more and more like you, less selfish and more selfless. Willing to deny ourselves in any and all situations, you have told us that when we lose our life for your sake, we will save it. Save us from ourselves, God. Amen.
Lord, your word speaks promises of healing and restoration, and we thank you for the miracles you still perform today. We believe in the healing power of faith and prayer, and we ask you to begin your mighty work in the lives of, just go ahead and speak those names out that you know need prayer today. God, we do lift up all the things that are going on in the different cities where there's chaos, where there's riots, where there's brokenness. Holy Spirit, I pray and we pray for the church in those cities and in those communities, that you would galvanize the body of Christ together to be salt and light and to serve those communities in such a way that would bring life and wholeness and healing. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we pray for those that are still dealing with the coronavirus. We pray for all those that are in the health community and the healthcare community, that God, that you would continue to be with them, to empower them, to be the hands of healing, to not walk in fear, to be love to those that are needed needed at that moment. Thank you, Lord Jesus, because you are doing a work in many lives. And we ask that, God, what you've started in that whole situation, that you'd bring it to completion in Jesus' name. Lord, please reach down and surround them in supernatural peace and strength and give them the faith to believe that all things are possible for you. Go ahead and pull out your communion. On the night that our Lord Jesus Christ was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and he said, take and eat, for this is my body broken for you. Let's take it together. After they had their supper, he took the cup and he gave it to his disciples again. He said, take and drink, for this is my blood poured out for you and for all mankind for the remission of your sins. Do this, and as you drink this together, do this in remembrance of me. Let's drink together. Let's share together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Our benediction this morning is taken out of 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 16. Now may the Lord of peace himself give you peace at all times, and in every way the Lord be with all of you. Amen.
Between the black skies and my red eyes, I can barely see. And when I'm feeling like I've been let down by my friends and my family, I can hear the rain remind me. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. When my hopes and dreams are far from me and I'm running out of faith, I see the future, our picture, slowly fade away. And when the tears of pain and heartache are pouring down my face, I find my peace in Jesus' name. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. And in the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm.
I just don't know how I'm gonna make ends meet. I did my best, now I'm scared to death that we might lose everything. And when a sickness takes my child away and there's nothing I can do,
what?
My only hope is to trust in you.
In the eye.
I trust you, Lord.
In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm.
Okay, so God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Woo!
Well.
Okay, folks, that's a lot.
Here we go.